between us and Paul. That being said, I hope it will be a useful session. And I thank you for getting here. I only have one slide, but it's a slightly bigger slide, I suppose. Anyway. Okay. This presentation. I'm here to present the results of a forensic survey that was sent out to all forensic, consultant psychiatrists earlier this year. And the genesis of this survey was really something that started when I met Professor Patrick Bing and Dr. Yap Kualing last year at a training workshop in Changi General Hospital. And long and short of it is that we felt there was a need to get a baseline of what the psychiatric community felt on forensic psychiatry. In fact, Mr. Calvin Phones and Nicholas Chok have very, very well set the stage for the results. Because everything they mentioned here, almost everything they mentioned, the issues that Professor Calvin Phones highlighted, will be addressed in some fashion in this survey that you're going to see. So, moving on. I'm going to tell you what we did, I'm going to tell you what we found, and lastly, I'm going to tell you what does it all mean. So, moving back. What we did was we sat down with the IMP for psychiatrists at dinner, had a quick chat, and through an iterative process, we developed a survey. And this survey was sent out, I believe, to all 143 registered consultants, psychiatrists at the time, from December last year till March this year. And what we did after that was analyze the data using appropriate tests. I'll leave you as that. This is a copy of the survey, the two pages. You'll see it details later, but like I said, this survey is not something that I dreamt up in the middle of the night. This is something that went through, don't worry, you'll see the details later. But this survey was something that we crafted together with the IMP psychiatrists in iterative fashion and was very carefully scripted and written to get as much information in a certain amount of time. So a two-page survey, I think psychiatrists mostly on this side of the room should be familiar with this, the junior ones on this side. Okay, so what did we find? This is divided up a little. Okay, more time on this. The results are, the quick general results of the demographics. We managed to get a 33% response rate. It's not too bad for this time survey, and we had 48 responses. So you get some data, some feeling of what's going on in the community. The average age of psychiatrists is 47, and there's a significant difference between the age of a private psychiatrist and the public. The private ones are older. Almost 10 years older. No surprise there. Most of the psychiatrists that replied were male, 30%, and most of them were in public practice. No surprise there. This is where it gets into the more specific part of the survey. And we ask people how much of their practice is forensic. And by their own assessment, the average figure is about 3.5%. But you can also notice there's a very wide standard deviation of 5.5. That goes less than zero, I know, but that's how the math pans out. As I recall, the range went from 0%, quite a few people had zero. It went up to as high as about 20 or 25% for a few individuals. So it's a wide range of results, which is why it's weird and variable. And there may be a difference between privates and the public, because privates seem to have slightly higher percentage, but the results are not statistically significant. Again, a huge variation, is a huge standard deviation for this, but again, this may not be unexpected. So now, I promised, we're going to go and look at questions. Four big parts to this, and we'll get there. First one is, we asked psychiatrists, what is a forensic psychiatric skill set? A bit different from what are the things we have to do, not the task, but what are the skill sets for us? And we asked, is it risk assessment, capacity / competence assessments, or critical appraisal of reported symptoms, or otherwise the double telling truth? So before I get to the survey, I will show you the results. Let's ask you to spend 5 seconds just thinking what percentage said yes and what percentage is no. Again, risk assessment, capacity, and critical appraisal. A few seconds of thought, and the results now. Here they are, last chance to think about it for yourself before we move in. First one, risk assessment and management. Basically, huge chunk of the overwhelming majority said it is a forensic skill set, no doubt there. Second question is about capacity and competence. Again, 83% overwhelming majority of psychiatrists agreed this was a forensic skill set. Slightly surprisingly, critical appraisal of treatment support is the bugger line. Slightly lower, but still overwhelming majority felt these three were all forensic skill sets. And of course, the open option of others was almost unused. So there's no other skill sets that the psychiatrist would contribute. That's first thing. The next set of questions we asked people were, who should be doing this? Another question that Professor Cullen-Jones brought up just now. And broadly, there are three options. Everyone, all psychiatrists, only psychiatrists with specialist forensic qualifications, or psychiatrists more restrictively in a specialist forensic psychiatric unit. Again, I'd like to give everybody a couple of seconds to think about what you think the response would be. And here are the results. Again, last chance to guess, but the colors are there. The consensus here is not quite so clear. Two-thirds of the psychiatrists felt that everyone should do it, but a significant minority felt that perhaps not everyone should. About whether it should only be forensic psychiatrists or psychiatrists with forensic training doing it, again, no clear consensus. Most people, 70% thought, no, it can't just be them, but a significant minority, again, almost a third, felt that perhaps it should just be them doing it. And the very last question about should it just be forensic psychiatrists in a specialist forensic unit, again, no really clear consensus, although it's a bit more skewed. 80% felt no. But again, one out of five psychiatrists surveyed felt maybe it should just be the psychiatrists in the forensic unit. So again, the consensus for this one, not quite so clear. Next set of questions asked people, this was a very difficult question. We asked psychiatrists to estimate how much time on average would you spend on three categories of assessments. Different types of cases. Capacity, civil, and criminal, and others. Others was empty, more or less. So we have some figures here. So we may be a little bit of an answer for this once you publish it. And this is the results. Quick answer is that there is a clear gradation between capacity to civil to criminal, with capacity being the lowest and the criminal being the highest. None of the differences are statistically significant, so we can't claim anything there. And the difference between the private psychiatrist and public psychiatrist, again, is not statistically significant, but there is a little bit of a trend. For almost all of the fields, the private psychiatrists, on average, seem to want to spend a little bit more time, if you look at it left to right, than the public psychiatrist. But I stress there's no statistically significant difference, and the standard deviation is not very narrow. It's quite significant. But this is a useful indication to get for the first time, I think, this is a ballpark figure of how much the psychiatrists in Singapore seem to think is the average amount of time for an average kind of assessment for capacity, civil, and criminal. The details will be available, so obviously no one needs to get this done. Last set of questions that we asked were then the questions that Professor Calvin-Jones brought us now. Is the duration to do the assessment an important factor? Number one. Number two. Is the first language of the assessor and the language used for the assessment an important factor? Third question, should the roles of the treating clinician and the assessing forensic psychiatrist, should they be separate? The last interesting question is, would it be useful to have an independent panel to make the assessment rather than an adversarial system? And I'll give you 2 seconds to think about what you think the responses would be. Okay. And here they are, last chance to think about it, moving on. Is the duration important? Again, the consensus is not quite so clear. 60% felt yes, but significant more than a third were no or maybe. So again, not quite a super clear consensus as opposed to the skill sets, but most people did think that the more time you spend, the time you spend is an important factor. Second question, how is it important that we speak the same language as the person being assessed? Even less of a consensus here. Most people felt it was good to have, not necessarily good to have, it was almost 60%. For almost 40% felt it was essential. And there were some that were, for whatever reason, said it's not required. I don't know about that. But it's almost split down the middle, about essential or good to have. And somebody said, doesn't matter, I don't know. This is the one about role, should the roles of assessor versus clinician be separate? And again, less of an even split down the middle, but again, 3/4 said
yes, they should be separate, but one